Thank you. Good evening. I would like to start my presentation with a story, a true story. I was seated on the sofa with my wife watching the TV, and all of a sudden, at the worst moment, of course, an error message popped up, and basically, your box, the temperature has overheated, please switch off and call your provider. And you know what? Of course, I was very upset. Needless to say that from a customer perspective, the customer experience was really kind of worse. And how can this happen in 2007? You know, the AI can beat the best Go player, and we cannot even predict that there will be a failure in your internet box. So what I would like today is to share some belief, and one of them being we need to speed up adoption of AI, because today there is very little usage of AI in the industrial world. So number one belief, I don't think we can move to the next step and speed up AI adoption without automating existing manual process. What I mean is today, if you want to build a predictive model, you have data science guys, you have data, you have algorithm, and then basically based on a very manual process, you will go back and forth to find an answer to these questions. In my opinion, it's a dead end. To some extent, this strategy will hit a glass ceiling. So my first feeling is we need to automate AI. The second one is, well, I like this quote, vision without execution is hallucination. It's Thomas Edison. And it's a little bit of the same. If you automate AI, and if you cannot seamlessly deploy this predictive model to solve the problem, then it's useless. The Gartner said that most of the time, one of the main reasons basically predictive models are not live, it's because it's complicated to basically go live and push this predictive model live. The third one, I would like to share with you the evolution of IT infrastructure and AI. If you remember a while ago, you know, the IT started with mainframe, then servers, then PC, then smartphones. So basically, the IT became more and more smart in our pocket. It's happening the exact same thing in infrastructure and in AI. In the past we had basic routers, and now a router, let's say a Cisco router. We have a partnership with Cisco, hence mentioning Cisco. Is literally as powerful as a really big server like five years ago. And it's the same for AI. If we keep AI either in the cloud or in servers, in centralized servers, then we will not be able to speed up. Hence, edge computing and fog computing. Gartner mentioned that in a blog that edge computing in the end might eat the cloud. So I'm not sure it's going to be the case, but for sure, AI will be over time more and more pushed at the edge, meaning in a router or even in the object. And the reason why is basically objects are pretty dumb when they are not connected. Let's take the box example. If there is no internet connection, every single IoT connected to the box will become dumb. So if you don't push artificial intelligence in the box, then objects will remain dumb. Last thing, because it's data driven. So I worked for like 15 years in marketing at Neolane. I'm one of the co-founder of Neolane, and as Fabrice focused on more marketing and customer intelligence, I'm going to focus on manufacturing for data. I just want to compare data marketing and data in the manufacturing business. The format. Number one, in marketing, basically you receive data, they are always unstructured and so on and so forth. In the manufacturing business, a machine, a sensor, will not send you data one day in a format and the other day in another. Privacy, you mentioned the privacy. There is much less privacy in the manufacturing because a machine will not complain if you gather more data from this machine. Same, well, volume, same, it's very similar. Real time, it's somehow similar. And project management, in the manufacturing business, it's much more easier to conduct project because they have a long history of project management. There are more structures, whereas in marketing, there is more a creative way of managing project. So my belief, my sort of prediction, is that the digital transformation, the adoption of AI in manufacturing is going to happen in roughly 5 or 6 years, whereas it's going to happen in 15, whereas it happened in 15 years in marketing. So one last thing I would like to share before switching to what we do and why is there is a huge resource challenge in AI because there is a limited number of resources, it increases the cost, and there is a lot of competition. So companies are in competition to get the best data scientists. So, and by the way, what about the existing team? The competency required to, let's say, to work in the AI space is untapped until now. So, basically, I would like to share with you what do we do. So about us, I will move forward quite quickly. We are a startup, as you mentioned. So the company was created in 2011. So we tried to solve some of the challenges we mentioned. So basically, we have an industrialized SaaS solution. Augmented expert is really important. So we don't think, I personally don't believe that AI will replace experts. AI will help engineers to be better. So we create augmented experts. So we help experts being better and deliver faster value. And the last sentence is really important, seamless deployment and integration. So we target three markets. I'm not going to cover customer intelligence today because there was a marketing example just right before, but it's industrial internet and IoT platform. If you want to do machine learning, if you want to solve the box problem, you need data. I will just comment for a few seconds the IoT platform. There is a boom at the moment, and every big company like Cisco, Amazon, G-Predix, they started 3 or 4 or 5 years ago. They've built internet, industrial internet platform. Basically, they collect data, they gather data, they structure the data, and they push that in the cloud so that third-party application can leverage this data to build predictive model. So this partner slide is meant to focus on Cisco because they strongly believe in edge computing. They really push this edge computing approach, meaning in a Cisco router today, we can not only push security application, but third-party application, predictive object can be embedded in these routers. And my belief, and we've done that with Wind Turbine, is that basically the predictive model that can make the local decision has to be pushed at the edge when possible. So what is exactly automated artificial intelligence? To describe the topic is quite easy because to predict something, basically you have a set of algorithms, you have a set of parameters and a set of data. So the automatic AI is meta-active machine learning. We have a patent. We'll drive you through this cube, and give you the optimal prediction accuracy. So it, in all these processes, on the left, it's either data management platform, and we start from data preparation, modeling, and so on and so forth. So I'm not going to through to a demo. It's just some screenshot to show that there is no R, there is no Python, there is no visible technology. Because I really believe that we need to make AI accessible and easy to use. So you log, basically you create a project. A project is divided into two steps. One is modeling, the other one is performance management. You leverage existing data, you select and customize and configure the data. Back one thing. There is something really important in this slide. You can add business tags. What is business tag? AI has to be very business focused. So if, well, let's say data will come with some metadata, some additional information, but it's very tech. There is no business in the metadata. You can add business tag. As an example, when we predict failures for wind turbines, it happened that the predictive model showed that the GPS localization had an impact on the failures, which makes sense. But in the end, in the predictive model, you cannot unscrew the four screw of the wind turbine to move the wind turbine 100 meters away. So upfront, you can define in this data what kind of data is actionable. Actionable means I can do something. I can act on this data. So very business oriented. You generate, and in the end, building the predictive model is that simple. You have small, medium, big. Do I want to go for a big analysis? It's going to take time, a large one, or a small one. A small one is really, I want to basically know in a very short period of time, an hour or two, is there something in this data? Can I get something? Failing in 9 months is a disaster. Failing in 9 hours is good news. So I want to really shorten the time you have to get something out of your data. So of course, you got some reporting. And then performance management and deployment. Basically, when you push the model, you define where you want to push. In the cloud, mobile app, IoT platform, could be GPredix, and at the edge. And then we track all the predictive model. That's also something that is missing most of the time. AI is based on continuous learning. So basically, if you do not update on a regular basis your model, it's useless to deploy it. So what is important, in my opinion, is really to make it simple, to leverage your existing team. You can use your existing engineer team, train them, let's say add 20% data science knowledge, and they can use this platform and they can use AI. So move forward. So let's do the math to build the model. Fail fast, learn fast. I know that failing is not a positive concept in Europe and in France in particular, but it's very important to fail fast and embedded. So let's share some use cases. I selected two use cases. One is part of the Digital GPredix certification program. And it's an exhausted gas temperature prediction. So basically, we had to predict when this temperature is going over a certain level, because then it creates a risk, and the pilot has to pilot his plane differently. So it's predictive monitoring. And then we explain the decision, of course. And the second one is battery failures. A couple of months ago, we've been building a predictive model that enables XI, our partner, to predict battery failures. It sounds easy, but it's not. You cannot predict failures with based on rules, I would say, because it depends whether you know it's cold, it's hot, whether it's winter or not, whether you will use your car many times in the day or not, and so on and so forth. So it's kind of complicated. And basically, these are fake numbers, but just to show you what we predict per battery, we could predict 3 days in advance and 7 days in advance whether this battery is going to fail. We can attach a business case, let's say for an insurance company. We can not only sell you an insurance per use, but also we can add some maintenance services. You are driving, you receive an SMS, in 3 days your battery may fail. You can go to this particular retailer and then you will get 30% discount. That's it for me. My belief to conclude is really in automated, embedded artificial intelligence.
Thank you, Benoît. Please join. So you told me something just before the presentation, but now you told me, now at Telme Plus, we don't do POC proof of concept anymore because it's useless. I mean, what do you mean by that? Because when you work with big corporations like, I mean, the car manufacturer or Airbus or people like that, usually when you're a startup, they're going to tell you, okay, let's do a POC. It's going to take some time and they're not going to pay you for the POC usually. And then after, they might decide to do something, but you might also lose your time. So can you just elaborate on that? I mean, how can you work with these big guys? I mean, you're a small guy. How you can you convince them to directly do business with you?
Yeah, so basically, doing a POC means that you do not involve enough the business. In the end, we don't use artificial intelligence just for the sake of using artificial intelligence. We use AI to solve business problems. So most of the time, when you do a POC, you have a data set, and they just ask you to predict something. So predict whatever, failure, and so on and so forth. And that's it. There is no business case attached. It means that you spend time, even if they pay you. Basically, we, as a startup, we are not unlimited in resources. So when we, let's say, try to predict for this particular POC, we don't use our resources for a more business-oriented POC. So I much prefer wait until these big companies have some business case attached, and that's what we did for a couple of big companies. And after 9 months, they tried many things, and then we moved in a more iterative process, set the platform, try, fail, but fast, and then in the end, get some benefits and some value out of it.
And just to finish on that question, so you usually work directly with the corporate or through partners or integrators or consulting companies that can help also to prove the value proposition to the corporate. How does that work usually?
So we have two type of partners. We have technical partners like Cisco, Google, to mention these two, and GPredix. So they help us, you know, speeding up the adoption of our technology. And number two, we have big integrators like Atos, and you are right, of course, they meet the business and they help us speeding up these business cases.
And your platform is on the shelf, or you need to customize it for each customer? I mean, do you need to sell also some integration services today, or some customization for each customer, or is it on the shelf, pretty much standardized? Where do you stand now?
Well, automatic AI, in theory, is agnostic because basically there is no preconceived ideas. You know, artificial intelligence will not say, "Hey, well, I don't think this hypothesis is valid," or "I have 20 years of experience in, let's say, manufacturing. I don't think that we should try this." AI will try everything, which means that in theory. Basically, there is little configuration. Anyway, we decided to focus on industry and customer intelligence, and we use partner to, let's say, bridge the gap between business and artificial intelligence, because you need some knowledge anyway. So basically, with a typical project is 1 month for what we call sprint zero, which is what do I need to do and do I have the data, and an additional 1 or 2 months to execute the sprint one for the first modeling. And yes, we leverage our partners to do that, CGI, Atos, and so on.
And the business model, sorry, I'm asking questions, so if you have questions, just be patient. And the business model is flat, or is based on the performance that, I mean, it's success-driven or performance-driven, or?
Yeah, that's a very valid question, because it's very difficult to build a business model on performance, because what does it mean? What is your added value in the chain, and so on and so forth. So to solve these questions, I have a flat price per year for the platform, whatever, number of users, and so on and so forth. And if you get value out of it, you pay an additional fee for each model live. So it's some sort of a shared risk model.
Okay, very interesting. Any question?
So the question is, how do you deal with this black box approach related to machine learning? Well, basically, we are not a white box, and I will explain why. We only use symbolic machine learning. We only use algorithms that can explain the decision. Because if, let's say, I predict that a machine or a customer is going to leave in 2 weeks' time, and that's it, the only difference is that you are not going to sleep well for 2 weeks, and that's it, because there is nothing you can do. So basically, we only use machine learning algorithm that can explain the decision, number one. So it's more like what is called a white box. So in the end, we manage to find the best model. And we give visibility on the model, and at the lower level, we explain pretty much everything. So the business, they like it, because we use them upfront to help business tagging the data. It goes really fast to find the first result or not. So fail fast, learn fast. And it's a very iterative process. They understand the output and they like it.
Any other question? I have one for you on the real time. So because on manufacturing, I mean, real time can be really critical. I mean, when you're operating an airplane, for example. So how do you manage that? Because, I mean, do you need to put, you talk about edge computing. That means you need to put all the intelligence, for example, inside the airplane. But can you share also knowledge between different airplanes? And again, because to improve the model. So how can you do that?
So, well, we need to define what real time is, because, you know, for a bank, real time can be a millisecond in some cases. So our response time today, number one, is 100 millisecond-ish. It's not that bad. But to answer your question about how can you embed with good performance and how can you share, basically what we need to execute is really very little capacity. The output when you press push is really a Docker with very little, computing requirements, right? So number one. Number two, by essence, machine learning can share. I mean, we track predictions, we track where the models are deployed, and we trigger the team, the business team, when there is a discrepancy between the prediction and the performance. And then they can decide to compute again the model and to go live or not. It's not automatic today. It's not a matter of, let's say, is it possible or not? It's just that I don't want to make the loop automatic today. I think it's still challenging.
Okay. Okay, question over there.
Yes, in the customer intelligence, Massif is using our platform Live for a couple of questions. So the first question was kind of difficult to fulfill because there was a culture gap to bridge, and now they have plenty of questions. So there is some sort of a traffic jam at the entrance of the platform. Motul, another kind of customer. Motul is the oil manufacturer, and basically they do two things. So they predict predict, let's say, the part numbers during the process, the manufacturing process. That's one thing. And the second project that is going to start in June is to build something that is fun. It's the how to translate that. It's the connected oil cap. So basically, we can measure the characteristic of the oil live, connected to your smartphone. And when, as a motorbike driver, you know, you go like this, so basically flat out, if there is potential risk for the engine, then there is an alert sent to your smartphone.
So smartphone.
Yeah. So that's a more fun one. Not yet there, but that's typically what we can do.
Okay, Benoît, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Thanks a lot.